Stimme Gottes, sei schien in das Wiener. Es soll wie der Güste käme springen.
No, no, will not despair, will not despair. For Gama would not dare to make of a deadly foe from ill and bad. And so, since you knock, 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 knock,
in an appearance at our court before the sun has set in yonder west, and if he fail to bring the Princess Ida with him, to whom our son Hilarion was betrothed at the extremely early age of one, there's war between King Gama and ourselves.
Oh, Cyril, how I dread this interview. Just 20 years since Gama and I have met. He was a twisted monster, all awry, as if Dame Nature, angry with her work, had crumpled it in fitful petulance.
But, sir, a twisted and ungainly trunk often bears goodly fruit. Perhaps he was a kind, well-spoken gentleman.
Oh, no. For Adelaide, his sting lay in his tongue. His sting is present, though his tongue is past.
But stay, my liege. O'er yonder mountain's brow comes a small body, bearing Gama's arms. And now I look more closely at it, sir. I see attached to it King Gama's legs, from which I gather this corollary, that the small body must be Gama's own.
Ha! Is the princess with him?
Well, my liege, unless her highness is a full 6 feet high and wears mustachios too and smokes cigars and rides uncovered in coat of steel, I do not think she is.
One never knows.
She's a strange girl, I've heard, and does odd things. Come, bustle then. For Gama, place the richest robes we own. For Gama, place our coarsest prison dress. For Gama, let our best spare bed be there. For Gama, let our deepest dungeon yawn. For Gama, lay the costliest banquet out. For Gama, place cold water and dry bread. For as King Gama brings the princess here or brings her not, so shall he have much more than everything, much less than nothing.
According to my strict command, on every hand, on every hand,
princess here, give him good cheer, give him good cheer.
If she come here, we'll give him a cheer, and we will show you how. Hip hip hurrah, hip hip hurrah, hip hip hurrah, hurrah, hurrah.
We'll jump and sing, we'll take the king and his daughter to our town.
We'll jump, hurrah, hip hip hurrah, hip, 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 hurrah.
Oh, the dead princess, if you could come up, hurrah.
Hip hip hurrah, hip hip hurrah, hurrah, hurrah.
We'll jump, we'll sing, we'll take the sting of the old familiar way.
We'll jump, hurrah, hip hip hurrah, hip, 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 hurrah.
As we take the end of the cross, hurrah, hurrah, hurrah.
King Guard is in sight, but much I fear with no princess.
Oh, alas, my liege. I've heard that Princess Ida has forsworn the world, and with a band of women shut herself within a lonely country house, and there devotes herself to stern philosophies.
Then I should say that the loss of such a wife is one to which any reasonable man would easily be reconciled.
Oh, no, or I am not a reasonable man. She is my wife. Has been for 20 years. I think I see her now.
Ha! Let me look!
In my mind's eye, I mean. A blushing bride, all bib and tucker, frill and furbelow. How exquisite she looked as she was born, recumbent in her foster mother's arms. How the bride wept, nor would be comforted, until the hireling mother for the nonce administered refreshment in the vestry. And I remember being much annoyed that she should weep at marrying with me. But then I thought, these brides are all alike. You cry at marrying me? How much more cause you'd have to cry if it were broken off? These were my thoughts. I kept them to myself, for at that age I had not learned to speak.
Ha! 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 I can. Yet everybody says I'm such a disagreeable man. They can't be why. I'm sure I'm no ascetic. I'm as pleasant as can be. You'll always find me ready with a crushing repartee, an irritating chum, I'm a celebrated sneer. I'm an entertaining snigger, I'm a fascinating ear. To everybody's prejudice, I know a thing or two. I can tell a woman's age in half a minute, and I do. But though I try to make myself as pleasant as I can, yet everybody says I'm such a disagreeable man, and I can't think.
He can't think why. He can't think why.
Well, this is Castle Hildebrand. Well, Dame Rumor whispered that the place was grand. She told me that your taste was exquisite, superb, unparalleled.
Oh, really, King?
But she's a liar.
Why, how old you've grown.
And is this a Valerian? Why, you've changed too. You're a singularly handsome child. Oh, are you a courtier? Come, come, quietly. Tell me some lies. What do you think of your king? Vile rumor says he's all but imbecile. Now, that's not true.
My lord, we love our king. His wife and marks are valued by his courtiers as precious stones.
And for the selfsame cause, like precious stones, his sensible remarks derive their value from their scarcity. Oh, come on. Be honest for once. Tell the truth. Tell it to me. I'll harm you not. His leg is crooked. The foot ill-designed. And his shoulder wears a hump. Come on, out with it. Look, it's my face. Am I not the worst of nature's blunders?
Nature never errs. To those who know the workings of your mind, your face and figure, sir, suggest a book appropriately bound.
Why, harkee, sir, how dare you bandy words with me?
No need to bandy aught that appertains to you.
Do you permit this, King?
We are in doubt whether to treat you as an honored guest or as a traitor knave. Who plights his word, then breaks it.
If the casting votes with me, I give it to the former.
We shall see. By the terms of our contract, signed and sealed, you were to deliver the Princess Ida here today. Why is she not with you?
Answer me this. What do you think of a wealthy, purse-proud man who, when he calls upon a starving friend, pulls out his gold, flourishes his notes, and flashes diamonds in the pauper's eyes? What name have you for such a one?
A snob.
Just so. Now, the girl has beauty, virtue, wit, grace, humor, wisdom, charity, and pluck. Would it be kindly, think you, for me to parade these brilliant qualities before your eyes?
No, King Hildebrand, I am no snob.
Stop that tongue, or you shall lose the monkey head that holds it!
Bravo!
Your king deprives me of my head, that he and I may meet on equal terms.
Where is she now?
In Castle Adamant, one of my many country houses. There she rules a woman's university, with full 100 girls who learn of her.
100 girls? 100 ecstasies?
But no mere girls, my good young gentleman. For all the college learning that you boast, the youngest there will prove a match for you.
With all my heart.
If she's the prettiest. Fancy, 100 matches. All alight. That's if I strike them as I hope to do.
Despair your hope. Their hearts are dead to men. He who desires to gain their favor must be qualified to strike their teeming brains. Their hearts? They're safety matches, sir. And they only light upon the knowledge box. So you've no chance.
Are there no males whatever in those walls?
None, gentlemen. Excepting letter males. And they're driven, as males often are, in other large communities, by women. Bless my heart. She's so particular, she'll scarce suffer Dr. Watts's hymns. And all the animals she owns are hers. The ladies rise at cockcrow anymore.
Then they have male poultry.
Not at all. The crowing's done by an accomplished hen. Perhaps we can undress the lady.
lady most politely, most politely. You'll remain as hostage here. Should Hilarion disappear, we will hang you, never fear. Most politely, most politely, most politely.
You'll remain as hostage here. Should Hilarion disappear, we will hang you, never fear. Most politely, most politely, most politely.
Was his plan. Tomorrow morn, their armor will engage. But we will use no force allowed to gain. Nature has armed us for the war we wage.
Necessarily severe.
Hear, hear. For a month to dwell in a dungeon cell, growing thin and risen in a solitary prison is a warlord mount for a soldier stout. With his longing for the rattle of a complicated battle, yes, his longing for the rattle of a complicated battle, and the round drum drum of the military drum, and the guns that go boom boom.
When Hilarion's pride has at length complied with the choice conditions of a requisition, you may go in haste
then indulge your taste. I'm a fascinating battle of a complicated bat. It's the fascinating battle of a complicated bat. For the rum-tum-tum of the military drum and the guns that go boom, boom.
The rum-tum-tum of the military drum, rum-tum-tum, tummy, 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 drum. It's only for the rattle of a complicated battle and the rum-tum-tum of the military drum.
Yeah. Princess Ida's list of punishments. First is Saccharissa. She's expelled.
Expelled?
For although she knew that no man of any kind may pass these walls, she dared to bring a set of chess men here.
I meant no harm. They're only men of wood.
They're men with which you give each other mate. And that's enough. Next is Chloe.
Uh-huh.
Chloe shall lose 3 turns. For yesterday, while looking through her drawing book, I found a sketch of a perambulator. A double perambulator. Shameless girl. Now, attention, pray, as your principal, the princess, comes to give her usual inaugural address to the young ladies that joined yesterday.
Thank you.
invites who thirst for such instruction as we give, attend while I unfold a parable. The elephant is mightier than man, yet man subdues him. Why? The elephant is elephantine everywhere but here. And man, whose brain is to the elephant's as woman's brain is to man's, that's the rule of three, conquers the foolish giant of the woods as woman in her turn shall conquer man. In mathematics, woman leads the way. The narrow-minded pedant still believes 2 and 2 make 4. Why, we can prove, we women, household drudges as we are, that 2 and 2 make 5, or 3, or 7, or 5 and 20 as the case demands. Diplomacy. The wiliest diplomat is absolutely helpless in our hands. He wheedles monarchs, woman wheedles him. Logic. Why, tyrant man himself admits it's a waste of time to argue with the woman. But then we excel in social qualities. The man professes that he holds our sex in utter scorn. I venture to believe he'd rather spend a day with one of you than with 500 of his fellow men. In all things, we excel, believing this. 100 maidens here have sworn to place their feet upon his neck. If we succeed, we shall treat him better than he treated us. But if we fail, then let hope fail too. Let no one can repent how she looks. Let red be worn with yellow, blue with green, crimson with scarlet, violet with blue. Let all your things misfit and you yourselves at inconvenient moments come undone. Let hairpins lose their virtue. Let the hook disdain the fascination of the eye. Let the bashful button modestly invade the soft embraces of the buttonhole. Let old associations all dissolve. Let Swan secede from Edgar, Sewell from Cross, Sears from Roebuck. In other words, let chaos come again. Today.
I, madam, on abstract philosophy. There I propose considering 3 points at length. The is, the might be, and the must. Whether the is from the actual fact is more important than the vague might be, or whether the might be from taking a wider scope is for that reason greater than the is. And lastly, how the is and the might be stand compared with the inevitable must.
Your subject's deep. How do you treat it, pray?
Madam, I take the 3 possibilities and strike a balance then between the 3. As thus, the princess is our head. Lady Psyche might be. Lady Blanche, neglected Blanche, inevitably must. Given these 3 hypotheses, to find the actual betting against each of them.
Your theme's ambitious. Pray you bear in mind, who highest soar, fall farthest. Fare you well, you and your pupils. Maidens, follow me.
And thus to every heart of every kind of love.
Oh,
command here. I was born to rule. But do I rule? I don't. Why? I don't know. I shall someday. Not yet. I bide my time. I once was someone, and the was will be. The present, as we speak, becomes the past. The past repeats itself, and so is future. This sounds involved. It's not. It's right enough.
And they'll set the Thames on fire very soon.
Very soon.
And they'll end.
this is Princess Ida's castle. Well, they must be lovely girls indeed if they require such walls as these to keep intruders off.
To keep men off is only half their charge, and that the easier half. I much expect the object of these walls is not so much to keep men off, as much as keep the maidens in. But what are these?
Why, academic robes, worn by the lady undergraduates when they matriculate. Let's try them on. Why, see? We're covered to the very toes. Three lovely lady undergraduates who, weary of the world and all its wooing...
And penitent for deeds is no undoing.
Look at the scans by well-conducted
maids. Seek sanctuary in these classic shades.
Join our ranks, and we'll subscribe to all our rules, 'tis well. To all your rules, we cheerfully subscribe.
You say you're noble women. Well, you'll find no sham degrees for noble women here. You'll find no sizes here, or servitors, or other cruel distinctions meant to draw a line twixt rich and poor. As for your fellow students, mark me well. There are 100 maids within these walls, all good, all learned, and all beautiful. They are prepared to love you. Will you swear the fullness of your love to them?
Upon our words and honors, ma'am, we will.
But we go further. Will you undertake that you will never marry any man?
Oh, indeed. We never will.
Consider well, for you must prefer our maids to all mankind.
To all mankind, we much prefer your maids.
We should be dolts indeed if we did not, seeing how fair.
Take care, that's rather strong.
But have you no lovers at your home who may pursue you here?
No, madam, none. We are homely ladies, as no doubt you see. And we have never fished for lovers' love. We smile at girls who deck themselves with gems, false hair, and meretricious ornaments to chain the fleeting fancy of a man, but do not imitate them. What we have of hair is all our own. Our collar, too, unladylike, but not unwomanly, is nature's handiwork, and man has learnt to reckon nature an impertinence.
Well, beauty counts for naught within these walls. If all you say is true, you'll spend with us a happy, happy time.
If, as you say, 100 lovely maidens wait within to welcome us with smiles and open arms, I think there's little doubt we shall.
Yeah.
In faith, the plunge is taken, gentlemen. For willy-nilly, we are maidens now. And maids, against our will, we must remain.
Catastrophe! Hilarion, this is my sister! She'll remember me, though years have passed since she and I have met.
Then make a virtue of necessity and trust our secret to her gentle care.
Psyche! Why don't you know me? Florian!
Florian!
My sister!
Oh, dear! What are you doing here? And who are these?
I am that Prince Hilarion to whom your princess is betrothed. I come to claim her plighted love. Your brother Florian and Cyril come to see me safely through.
The Prince Hilarion? And Cyril, too? How strange! My earliest playfellows.
Why, let me look. Are you that learned little Psyche who at school alarmed her mates because she called a buttercup Ranunculus Bobosus?
Are you that lady Psyche who at children's parties drove the conjurer wild, explaining all his tricks before he did them?
Are you that learned little Psyche who at dinner parties brought into dessert would tackle visitors with, "You don't know who first determined longitude. I do. Hipparchus twice. B.C. 163. Are you indeed that small phenomenon?
That small phenomenon indeed am I. Gentlemen, it is death to enter here. We have all sworn to renounce mankind.
Renounce mankind? On what grounds do you base this senseless resolution?
Senseless? No. We have been taught, and being taught believe, that man, sprung from an ape, is an ape at heart.
That's rather strong.
The truth is always strong. Thank you.
are men?
Well, yes, just now we are, but told by dint of study to become, in course of time, young women.
Oh, no, 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 don't do that.
Is this indeed a man?
I've often heard tell of him, but till today, never set eyes on one.
They told me men were hideous, idiotic, deformed. Well, they're quite as beautiful as women are. As beautiful, they're infinitely more so. Their cheeks have not that pulpy softness which one grows so weary of in womankind. Their features are more marked. And oh, their chins, how curious.
Oh, I fear it's rather rough.
Don't apologize. I like it so. Your only son.
second here. You should be first. Assist the prince's plan, and when he gains the Princess Ida, why, you will be first. You will design all the flashes, think of it, and always serve out all the punishments. The scheme is harmless, Mother. Wink at it.
The prospect's tempting. Well, I'll try. Though it's been years since I've winked at anything. Tis but one step towards my destiny. The mighty must, the inevitable shall.
Well, an appetite keen I am. And I'll subdue it. With cold roast lamb.
Yes, we'll subdue it with cold roast lamb. They're hearing the luncheon bell.
Hilarion?
Exactly. Is he well?
If it be well to droop and pine and mope, to sigh, oh, Ida, Ida, all day long. Ida, my love, oh, my life, oh, come to me. If it be well, I say, to do all this, then Prince Hilarion is very well.
He breathes our name. Well, it's a common one. And is the booby comely?
Pretty well. I have heard it said that if I dressed myself in Prince Hilarion's clothes, supposing this consisted with my maiden modesty, I might be mistaken for Hilarion's self. But what is this to you or me, who think of all mankind with undisguised contempt?
Contempt? Why, damsel, when I think of man, contempt is not the word.
I'm sure of that. Or if it is, it surely should not be.
Be quiet, idiot, or they'll find us out.
The Prince Hilarion's a goodly lad.
You know him, then?
I rather think I do. We are inseparables.
Oh, why, what's this? You love him, then?
Oh, we do indeed. All three.
Madam, she jests.
Remember where you are.
Jests? Why, I should say not. Why, bless my heart alive. You and Hilarion, when at the court, rode the same horse together.
Stride?
Of course, why not? Wore the same clothes. And once or twice, I think, got tipsy in the same good company.
Oh, why, these are nice young ladies, on my word.
Don't you remember that old kissing song he used to sing to the hostess of the pigeons? Thus it ran. Would you know the kind of maid? Sets my heart aflame. Eyes must be downcast and stained. Cheeks must flush for shame. She may neither dance nor sing, but demure in everything. Hang her head in modest way, with pouting lips, with pouting lips.
should I wish to live?
I'll storm your walls and weather your halls in the twinkling of an eye.
party of you choose to soak in the blues, I'll make the whole of you shake and shoot. Cross all your balls and deliver your balls in a twinkling on an eye. For I'm a peppery potentate who's little inclined his play to bait. Wit, the wit, and the wit, the chit, and that's the long and the short of it.
Oh, he's a peppery potentate who's little inclined his play to bait. To wit, the wit, and the wit, and the chit, and that's the long and the short of it.
can meet man face to face on his own ground and beat him there. Now, let us set to work. Where is our lady surgeon?
Madam, here.
We shall require your skill to heal the wounds of those that fall.
What? Heal the wounded?
Yes.
And cut off real legs and arms?
Of course.
I wouldn't do it for £1,000.
Are you faint-hearted, girl? Well, you've often cut them off, in theory.
In theory, I'll cut them off again with pleasure and as often as you like, but not in practice.
Coward! Get you heads! I've craft enough for that, and courage, too. I'll do your work. Ah, my fusiliers, advance!
We left them in the armory for fear that in the heat and turmoil of the fight they might go off.
They might. Oh, craven souls, go off yourselves. Thank heaven I have heart that quails not at the thought of meeting men. I'll discharge your rifles. Off with you. Ah, where is my band mistress?
Please you, ma'am, the band don't feel well and can't come out today.
Oh, why, this is flat rebellion. I don't have time to talk to them just now. But, happily, I can play several instruments at once and will drown the shrieks of those that fall with trumpet music, such as soldiers love. Ah, how stand we with respect to gunpowder? My lady Psyche, you who superintend our laboratory, are you well prepared to blow those bearded rascals into shreds?
Why, madam, let us try gentler means. We can dispense with fulminating brains while we have eyes with which to flash our rage. We can dispense with villainous saltpeter while we have tongues with which to blow them up. We can dispense, in short, with all the arts that brutalize the practical polemist.
Oh, I never knew a more dispensing chemist. Away! Away! I will meet these men alone, since all my women have deserted me.
Please, you do not hurt us. Please, you let us be. Frightened fates are we. Frightened fates are we.
So fail my cherished plans. So fails my faith. And with it, hope. And all that comes of hope.
Oh,
you.
Admit them.
Infamous. One's brothers, ma'am, are men.
Oh, so I have heard. But all my women seem to fail me when I need them most. In this emergency, even one's brothers may be turned to use.
My daughter.
Father, thou art free.
Aye, free as a tethered ass. I come to thee with words from Hildebrand, whose duly given I must return to blank captivity. I'm free so far.
Your message?
Hildebrand is loath to war with women. Pit my sons, my three brave sons, against Telerion and his friends, these popinjays, these tufted jackadangly featherheads. And on the issue, let thy hand depend.
Insult on insult, Ed! Are we a stake for fighting men? What fiend possesses thee that thou would come with offers such as these from such as he to such a one as I?
I am possessed by the pale devil of a shaking heart. My stubborn will is bent. I dare not face the devilish monarch's black malignity. He tortures me with torments worse than death. I haven't anything to grumble at. He finds out what particular meats I love. Gives me them. The choicest wines, the costliest robes, the richest rooms are mine. He suffers none to thwart my simplest plan and gives strict orders that none should contradict me. He's made my life a curse.
Oh, my poor tortured father.
Sarcastic joke, repeat with malice spiteful. These people mild and politely smiled and looked at me delightful. Now when a wife sits up all night in nature, jokes devising, and all his wiles and many smiles, it's hard, there's no disguising. Oh, don't the basic black and law when all goes right and nothing goes wrong? And isn't your life extremely flat? Nothing whatever. Music stands played Wagner imperfectly. I bade them go. They didn't say no. Off they went directly. The organ boys, they stopped their noise with regularness surprising. And grinning herds of hurdy-gurds retired apologizing. Oh, there the basic blanket blow when all goes right and nothing goes wrong. Isn't your life extremely flat with nothing whatever to run? Sums untold to all who'd contradict me. I said I'd pay £1 a day to anyone who kicked me. I bribed with toys, made vulgar boys to utter something spiteful. Unless you know they won't be so confoundedly politeful. Oh, in short, he's angry, beating, badly, tick my taste, they beat my fads. They give me this, they give me that, and nothing whatever could run the lads.
Why? why. You look handsome in your women's clothes. Stick to them. Men's attire becomes you not. And you, young ladies, were you pleased to pray King Hildebrand to set me free again? Hang upon his neck, gaze into his eyes. He never could resist a pretty face.
You dog, you'll find, though I wear women's garb, my sword is long and sharp.
Oh, hush, my pretty one. Oh, here's a virago, here's a termagant. If length and sharpness go for anything, you'll want no sword, but you can wag your tongue.
Why waste words on him? He's old and decrepit.
Yes, but I've three sons. Fine fellas, young, muscular, brave, they're well worth talking to. Come, what do you say?
Aye, pretty ones. Engage yourselves with us, if three rude warriors affright you not.
Old as you are, I'd wring your shriveled neck if you were not the Princess Ida's father.
If I were not the Princess Ida's father, and so had not her brothers for my sons, no doubt you would wring my neck. And in safety, too. Come, come, Valerian, begin. Begin. Give them no quarter. They'll give you none.
This helmet, I suppose, was meant to ward off blows. It's very hot and weighs a lot. As many guardsmen knows, as many a guardsman knows, as many a guardsman knows, as many a guardsman knows. So up, so up that helmet goes.
Yes, 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 so up that helmet goes.
This tight-fitting cuirass is but a useless mask. It's made of steel and weighs a deal. This tight-fitting cuirass is but a useless mask. The man is but an ass who fights in a cuirass. So up, so up goes that cuirass.
Yes, 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 so up goes that cuirass.
These brassets, truth to tell, may look uncommon well, but in a fight they're much too tight. They're like a lobster shell. They're like a lobster shell.
Yes, 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 they're like a lobster shell.
These things I treat the same, I quite forget their name. They turn one's legs to cribbage pegs. Then I must disclaim. Then I must disclaim. Though I forget their name, though I forget their name, may I thus disclaim.
Yes, yes, yes,
may I thus disclaim.
Post results.
Will you then take my place?
To answer this, it's meet that we consult the great potential mysteries. I mean, the five subjunctive possibilities. The may, the might, the would, the could, the should. Can you resign? The prince may blame you. If he might, you could. And if you should, I would.
I thought much. Then to my fate I yield. So ends my cherished scheme. Oh, I had hoped to band all women with my maiden throng and make them all abjure tyrannic man.
A noble aim.
Oh, you ridicule it now, but if I carried out this glorious scheme, at my exalted name posterity would bow in gratitude.
But pray reflect. If you enlist all women in your cause and make them all abjure tyrannic man, the obvious question then arises, how is this posterity to be provided?
Oh, I never thought of that. Lady Blanche, how do you solve this riddle?
Don't ask me. Abstract philosophy won't answer it. Take him. He is your shall. Give in to fate.
And you desert me. I alone am staunch.
Madam, you placed your faith in woman. Well, woman has failed you utterly. Try man. Give him one chance. It's only fair. Besides, women are far too precious, too divine to try unproven theories upon. Experiments, the proverb says, are made on humble subjects. Try our grosser clay and mold it as you will.
Remember, too, dear madam, if at any time you grow weary of the prince, you can always return to Castle Adamant and rule your girls as heretofore, you know.
Shall I find the Lady Psyche here?
If Cyril, ma'am, does not behave himself, I think you will.
And you, Melissa, shall I find you here?
Madam, however Florian turns up, unhesitatingly I answer, no.
Consider this, my love. If your mama had looked on matters from your point of view, I wish she had, then where would you have been?
Now there's a field of speculation on which I could discourse for hours.
No doubt, we will not trouble you.
Clarion, I have been wrong. I see my error now. Take me, Clarion. We will walk the world, yoked in all exercise of noble end, and so through those gates across the wild that no man knows. Indeed, I love thee. Come.